So can we talk about the tour and obviously with the new album as well? Talk about that. I mean, what sort of? I mean, I've sort of got a rough idea why you made the music. I know you got sort of you went to was it the Antarctica or the Arctic? I can't remember which one it was, or Greenland or something.
Well, it was Greenland. We were it was a bizarre project, but with the BBC, BBC Two got together with Discovery Channel, and we recreated Scott's expedition to the Antarctic using the original equipment.
Yeah.
And then let me get Greenland because you can't take dogs into Antarctica anymore.
Oh,
because it's a particularly pristine environment. So it was as close as you can get while being allowed to do all the fun stuff. So yeah. But I mean, led to me being on it because I'm not really a massive outdoors person, I didn't really have a big background in it. But a friend of mine, who's a doctor, he's like an expedition doctor. He was doing a lot of that at the time, and so he was on the team as the doctor, and then someone dropped out, and Chris knew that that my great grandmother had been married to Scott before she was married to my great grandmother.
Oh my goodness!
And so in this slightly kind of strange roundabout way, my entire family owes its existence to Scott failing to return.
Oh, wow. Wow, okay.
And so there's this kind of nice kind of link. And so Chris just said, oh, do you want to go on this thing? And I didn't quite realise quite what it was.
Gosh.
And I think Chris didn't realise quite how little I had been camping before. we just went and did this. We went and did this crazy 3 months on the ice. And it was pretty... It was pretty intense, but also incredibly boring. So it's this kind of mixture of so the temperatures of like -20, -30, going dropping down further in storms, and it was all moments were quite kind of dangerous. And then, but at the same time, you're walking every day for sort of 16 hours in a completely featureless white expanse, and if the wind goes away, it gets quite warm, and it's complete silence. And so this was the sort of what I was reminded of it all when we were doing a project last year with Greenpeace.
Yeah.
Where they had lots of, well, it was a concert and some commissions to help their, they've got a campaign called Protect the Oceans.
Yeah.
And it's about the ocean around Antarctica specifically. And so they had lots of footage of, of these kind of tundra expanses and things. And it just, it sort of, it kind of brought it all back, and I remembered that the thing that struck me in Greenland was that if you're in an environment completely devoid of sound and features, then I'd just be thinking about music the whole time, and there's literally nothing else. You can kind of almost hear things.
Okay.
And then you can kind of I was coming up thinking of composing things in my mind and then sort of trying to write them down some way when you get to the tent at the end of the day.
Yeah.
But it's actually that thing of just like absolute silence is a really beautiful, it's quite a productive.
It allows the
creative scene.
Yeah, I was going to say, is it create? Sorry for the delay in the phone here. I guess it's because you've got you're devoid of sound. You can sort of, the creativity just comes out in your head, and you think of the music.
Yeah.
Has that been the best sort of experience you've had then of sort of coming up with some music? I mean, can you sort of come up with music wherever you are in the world? Was that probably one of the best times you've come up with some of the best music you've written?
Well, I think it's when I came up, that's when I decided that I was going to come back and really do composition. Mm. So I went off to Goldsmiths and did a master's in composition after that. And I think that was the experience where I just felt that, this is kind of what I want to do. And this is kind of, it's a language that I'm I feel I'm probably better at this than anything else I'm looking at. So this is probably a good idea. I'll try and do this. And so it was, I think that's where I found the basic confidence to grapple with being a composer. Because I don't really, normally get a card.
Yeah. So with yourself, I mean, obviously I know about your dad and the history there, but I mean, it's quite rare for, say, somebody who to be the son of someone who's such a genius to become a genius themselves in music. You know, you're so talented. I mean, but was it always inevitable that you would follow in his, I say follow in his footsteps lightly. I don't mean that without being rude or, but do you know what I mean?
No. I mean, it's absolutely, I mean, it's kind of, I think, there is a huge continuity, like for me, between Penguin Cafe Orchestra and obviously, you know, that's why we call it Penguin Cafe now.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's very much based on my dad's thing. And I mean, I think it's a responsibility that I'm keenly aware of the thing, because I don't want to kind of muddy the footprint that he left. Mm. But at the same time, it's so kind of, I mean, we play a lot of his music.
Yeah.
And I try and, you know, I mean, we sort of try and explore different bits of the landscape, but we try and stay true, like, you know, stick with the aesthetic, you know, the approach that he had.
Yeah.
Because I think it's really, I just love it. And obviously, yeah, it's the main part of my musical education, is my dad's stuff, so. I think, because there are always musical instruments around the house, and so from when I was 4 or 5 years old, I'd be kind of playing piano and, you know, doing whatever. Kind of, you learn the vocabulary and you kind of internalise it.
Mm.
Like, if you do it like that. So yeah, I think that was always a possibility. And as I say, it was the decision to go jump in with both feet. Mm. Sort of came after the fact, if you know what I mean. Yeah. Yeah.
And did he see the potential what you had?
I never played on stage with him, but I mean, he died when I was 18. And I was never good enough. Well, I hadn't come along enough, and I think it would have been, just embarrassingly non-artistic if that had happened. Me and my dad, finding music that we both liked was a good exercise. Because you had to go, because when you're 14 years old, you often like really stupid music. So, so we found a lot of stuff that we shared. Mm. And I think, as I got older, obviously, as your kind of tastes, come into more focus. Mm. I think we had a really nice, a nice sort of shared, a shared kind of base of the way to think about music, and also finding cool things.
Mm. I mean, it must have been quite bold, though, for you to, when you did the reunion sort of thing with the PCO, do you know what I mean? Were you sort of talked into doing that? Was that something you sort of ran with yourself, or was it something the other band members sort of said, oh, you can do this? I mean, how did it come about?
It was a mark 10 years since my dad had died.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
And so I got together. Yeah, it's like, well, my dad and Helen Liebman, the cellist from Penguin Cafe, they were together in a relationship for the last few years of my dad's life, and so we were always in touch with quite a few of the band anyway.
Mm.
And it was just a nice thing to do, to kind of come back together to celebrate and kind of to have the music live again in the live room.
Yeah.
It wasn't planned to be like an ongoing thing. I think it is. We did 3 nights at the Union Chapel, and it was absolutely brilliant. And the first time I'd ever played on stage.
Mm. Okay.
I'd been doing film and TV and advert music and stuff that, but hadn't been performing as a per se. And it's a funny one. So the first night was amazing, and the second night, the music develops as you play it, and it changes, and I think it's in the nature of my dad's music especially, that there's kind of, you don't want to pin anything down too hard, because then you don't want to kind of, to kill it, or not kill it, but you don't want to kind of dehumanise it too much. And but the thing is, then you have to have someone, a sort of benign dictator in the middle of it, saying yes or no.
Yeah.
To particular things, because it's as much about what you don't do as what you do. And by the third night, I think everyone was sort of starting to try out ideas that they'd always wanted to do, and my dad had always said no.
Okay.
And I just didn't have the authority to kind of to say yes or no to obviously these young musicians were much older than me and much more experienced and much better. So, so it just didn't quite have the legs to go forward. But it was a lovely thing. It was an amazing thing to have the music live again. It's like meeting old friends. You know, like it was just such a kind of happy and natural feeling. And then, so that kind of that ran its course. And it was a couple of years later that I was asked to do a musical bit at a small festival some friends were organising in Italy.
Okay.
And so I just took three people. I took Darren Berry, Andy Waterworth, and Tom Chichester Clark, who were just the people I was working with at the time.
Okay.
And so that was bass, keys, guitar, drums. We sort of just picked up anything and just did a few of my dad's tunes, and it very quickly. So that then led to a lot of people at that festival booked us for stuff back in London through that winter.
Yeah.
And we did loads of Christmas parties. And then every time we played, we'd get another musician. Yeah, so Andy's sister plays cello. And our mate Neil, he's like great at keyboards. And
Neil Codling, yeah.
Neil Codling, yeah. So he's like keys and guitars and stuff. And it just meant that we could do that many more pieces.
Okay.
And it kind of grew very naturally. There was every new edition was like, friend or just, it was all very kind of, so it was a bunch of friends basically by the time we got up to 9, 10, 11.
Yeah.
we've been up to 12 at one point, but then,
but then
Pete, the percussionist, he went off to Thailand for a month.
Okay.
So now we're back down to a pool of 11.
So it's 11 during this tour?
No, we tour with 7 at the moment.
Okay.
It's our super, super trip, and we can all fit in one van.
Right. But you're not going in one van, are you? Seriously, are you going in one van? No, you're joking.
Yeah, no, splitter, because you've got, so we have our tour manager and sound engineer, and then 7 on stage, and that's, 9 of us.
Bloody
hell. So we'll get in there. it's not that spacious. But
no, I was going to say. Also, I'm surprised. Especially with the instruments, Jesus.
Well, it's the customised sprinters. Long wheelbase sprinter.
Oh, okay.
I hope in this coming year, next year, to get back up to a sort of, get back up to 9, 10.
Yeah,
on stage, because it's sort of because you get that when you really feel every extra pair of hands just does make a huge difference, and it's it's sort of the economics and the logistics.
Yeah. Is it then when you're writing the music, composing the music, do you sort of always have an idea that you know what instrument you've got in the band at the time? Do you know what I mean? Or is it something sometimes you'll think I could use this and I haven't got this, so I need to get this instrument player. Do you know what I mean? Or you've always got it in mind?
I tend to use what we've got.
Okay.
We've got so I've just bought a new instrument, a balafon, a Gambian balafon.
Yeah.
Which is a sort of rosewood job, which is absolutely amazing. I think we'll, start getting that up next year. There's a few of us who would be able to, would be perfectly happy to kind of, start having a go at that and see if you can get some good tunes out of it. And so it's, with a degree of flexibility, we can turn our hand to sort of strings, percussion, keys, guitar-y things. Yeah, most of us can have a bash at these things. So it gives you quite a sort of range to choose from. But we don't really have woodwind or brass.
Okay.
They're really hard.
Yeah, I was going to say it's a bit of a, yeah. I've been to a few orchestras recently and I know they're the most difficult ones.
Exactly. They're just not ones that you can't just pick it up and have a go.
No.
Get a
tuber
out.
Yeah. So with yourself then, I came across, your music yourself. I knew about your dad and stuff, but I came across yourself via Café Del Mar, the albums, like the compilation albums, I've been to Ibiza many times, and you sort of, and you think, I've heard that song before, you heard it before, and then when you start looking at Café Del Mar, you think, oh, okay, it's this band or this group, whatever, then you find out it's yourself, and you know, when you do more research and you find out, actually, you've written more and more and more and more. So many songs I know that I guess the audience that come to your shows will be the same sort of thing. They'll know one or two songs, but then they'll think, wow, I didn't realise he did that. Are you happy with that? I mean, are you sort of...
Very much, yeah. I mean, that's kind of... That's the good work. So I think, especially because it's instrumental, there's kind of... I mean, there's something about, like, lyrics and song titles, which that gives it quite an easy... Kind of easy to kind of remember what it is.
Yeah.
Lyrics give you a kind of fairly easy hook to hang it on.
Yeah.
Whereas I think with a lot of... I mean, stuff by my dad, like Perpetuum Mobile, which is... That's just... Most people know that tune in some shape or form.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they've seen the adverts or whatever.
Yeah. But
there's a few that... I mean, there's a few others in there that... Yeah, I think it's... They kind of have their journey. And so, I mean, it's quite interesting just watching what gets played, the play counts on Spotify.
Yeah.
Because it's quite odd. Like, some will just pop out from the old back catalogue.
Yeah.
It's just not entirely clear why. That's the beauty of it, isn't it? Like, because, you know, it's nice to have, albums from a few years ago that are still kind of, making their way around.
Yeah, I mean, you know, look at Redbook. I mean, the Redbook, I mean, that's still popular. I mean, you know, you've got tracks on there. But, I mean, there's a few diverse, not a lot diverse, but as someone, that album, what I remember from memory is that a couple or a few were done for NASA or something like that. Is that right? Commissioned by NASA?
Yeah, yeah,
and a few of them, some of them weren't. Like Solaris and, I can't remember, Aurora maybe, top of my head.
Aurora was part of it, and then 1420 was there. 1420 was the actual that did get used they got as part of a data packet that they beamed out into space as part of the project.
Okay. I think. Oh yeah.
which was very good fun. I mean, there's a lot. There's a lot of potential in that whole space thing. I was doing some stuff last year with a friend. Well, just working with one of the astrophysicists who were working on the team that detected gravitational waves.
Yeah, okay.
And they've just won the breakthrough prize as well, actually.
Okay.
So there's like really good sonic stuff to play with. I think that'll probably be the next thing after you do this album. Can get back into the space.
Do you think, though, that you would benefit? I don't know, this is like being ludicrous now, but you know, you touched on it earlier when you said about the silence of being in the Antarctica and Greenland where it's just quiet. Imagine what would inspire you if you were in space where there's nothing, nothing at all. Can you imagine?
Can you imagine?
Can you imagine?
The thing, like just the wonder.
But the cost has been ridiculous. The training.
Who's
that mind?
It's quite inspiring.
I mean, you must be inspired yourself, though, when you look at, say, Spotify or, say, Apple Music, that you can see that at the top of the hill is one of the most played songs of your catalogue at the moment. Have you noticed that?
I haven't checked it in the last few days, but... this is the great thing about being with our new label, because they're very good at, they've got their own sort of listener base, if you see what I mean.
Okay.
I mean, because Raised Tapes, they have quite a small roster of artists. I think it's only got like 10 or 12 acts. Okay. And so they have, it's really carefully curated. And I think we've definitely benefited from, people who like other stuff on the label will then kind of, they'll check us out. And I think they're quite a kind of, not be quite a Spotify sort of group of cats.
Well, you know, but it sounds like you've got birds in the background or seagulls, are you?
I'm just at the house in the garden. the signal's not always great inside.
You're in the UK, yeah?
Yes, in Kentish Town, London.
Oh, you got seagulls in Kentish Town?
gulls,
right? Yeah, no. So, I live in Wales, and I live by the sea, and we get birds. So it's just sounding like you were by the seaside. It was really surreal. Sorry.
Well, Kentish Town. Sure I'm not.
No, Kentish Town's definitely not.
Yeah.
My girlfriend used to live in Dartmouth Park, so I know it quite well. So.
Amazing. Yeah. No, that's where we'd like to. We might move next. We could have just had our first child.
Oh, congratulations, mate! Honestly, I've got one daughter, so that's us. Yeah. So. Oh well, congratulations. So you want a bit more space, I guess, a bit more by Hampstead Park or something. Hampstead East.
Exactly, just go up to the Heath and it's pretty close already, so it's
No doubt you will. With the new album then, mate, I mean, for me, my standout track on the new album is it's either Chapter or it's either the Chinstrap.
Ah, cool. That one came out. I was really happy with how that ended up.
And is that to do with the Penguins chin strap? Is that right?
Yeah, exactly. And it's so we had these four core tracks: Chin Strap, Gentoo, A Daily, and Emperor.
Okay.
The idea was just that those four species of penguins are the only ones that technically live in Antarctica.
Right.
Other ones visit, but those ones hang out there a lot. And it was quite fun creating the story. So around the characteristics, the differences between the penguins. And so chinstraps are the most sort of gregarious and social. All those ones. So it's this thing, and then also the idea of when they dive, they all look great when they dive, but they're just some footage that we have from Greenpeace.
Right.
Over at these chin straps going down, and so that's the kind of transition into the mid lake. when they go swimming.
Yeah. it's sounds like you've got the ultimate job anyway, the perfect job, but then to experience this as well for your work. You know, for the music, just to witness all this, it's just even makes it better, doesn't it? It's just, you've been stuck in the studio, you know, all the time.
yes.
I know you will be, but.
Yeah, it's that thing, isn't it, because now I just have a kid, now's the time probably when I would rather be just at home, not doing those stuff, but then with the album tour, and we've got a bunch more dates coming through in January, so. It's actually proving quite tricky to get time in the studio, let alone time here.
Yeah, I understand with families, it can be a pain in the ass.
It's that thing. It's such a privilege and such a lovely thing.
Everything changes, doesn't it? Everything changes. I know from my daughter, she's 11 now, and she's gone to big school now, and it's just. You'll be there soon, so.
Blinking, it'll be there, yeah.
It will, mate. I know people say it, and it's an old, you know, like everyone always says, it'll just fly by, and it will fly by. Just make the most.
No, I know, it's already. We're 4 months in, I think. And it really feels like, it's been very quick.
Yeah. Can I just say about on the tour then? How do you go about deciding on what you're going to? I mean, are you going to play the new album, which is obvious, I reckon. But how do you go about?
What we did in 2017 with the last one, and it worked quite well. Yeah. Was basically we did the album tour without any support, and you just do it. So the first half of the show, you play the album.
Yeah.
And then the second half, you can play the ones that people might know and the familiar stuff.
Yeah.
Do the classics and then make sure everyone's kind of goes home and heard the ones they want to hear.
Yeah.
And it's also quite nice that way because it means you get a sense of, so playing stuff from the album, you start off very much doing it like it sounds on the record. And then by the end of the tour, a lot of the tunes have actually changed quite a lot. So you do get this kind of, it's the live version kind of moving away from the recorded versions. Every night it just becomes that much. It goes off in some other direction.
So I was going to ask you, because I know like with your sort of music, it's the album's written in a way where you listen to the tracks in a set way, like a linear way. Do you know what I mean? I guess that's with the night when you play with the tour. It's like you just said. I guess it says the album listing is. That's how the listing of the night will be. But you can sort of tinker with it now and again, like you say.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's the joy of having. I mean, well, structurally, it's all going to stay pretty much the same. I think because you've all got to change key at the right time. But the feel, like, so when you're playing stuff live, you know, so you're like, it's. you know, there's no tempo grid, and and then as everyone gets to know the tunes and the little moments, you get like a dynamic variation that kind of beds in a way that, like probably wouldn't be there on the record because that's done in the studio in a kind of different, it's not better or worse, but it's sort of just a different environment.
You and your father, I mean, I would guess you were, this is like a completely silly question. Well, not a silly question, a different question. You're classed as like, I don't know, like a Beethoven type Mozart modern day equivalents, aren't you, I guess? I mean, is that something which, let's be honest, you are, because, if you were born, say, 300 years ago, you would be the Beethoven or Mozart of the time, I think that, because I think with the music you create, it's just, it's folk music interspersed with a bit of classical, and then it can be taken as dance, like trance music, like, tranquil sort of relaxing music. It's got everything there. But is that something you've always, for yourself, I know you can't speak on behalf of your dad, but is that something you've always wanted to do from when you were younger? I mean, I know I read something that you said you smashed up your dad's piano or something with a hammer. I don't know if that was true or not.
That is. We've still got the piano. It's,
seriously?
It took all the lips off the key and the ivory, or I don't know if it's ivory, it's probably plastic. But it's actually you have to play it quite carefully because they're all quite pointy and sharp still.
Oh, shit.
It's not something. It's not an exercise I'd recommend to any piano owners.
No. Okay. But is that something you've always wanted to do, though, from an early age? Then? Is it something? Were you always into the classics? Were you always into, your dad's music, or was it something that just came about later on? Or,
well, no, I think the nice thing about Penguin Cafe Orchestra approach is that you don't really worry too much about sort of genres. It's much more about the particular musical ideas or a composer or whatever it is, but it's sort of, you don't have to even if you don't know much about a particular kind of music, you're still my dad's always perfectly happy to jump in and have a go. And it is sort of punk in that sense. It's kind of it kind of came from that, because my dad knew Malcolm McLaren and Bow Wow Wow and all those guys, mid-70s, and they, it was that thing of, pick something up, have a go, and you might as well record it and see where you end up. So it is quite kind of, I think it was kind of a response to the slightly more kind of exclusionary thing, this kind of like fusty modern classical music thing where a lot of it isn't, and so the accessibility is a bad thing. These sort of ideas. So if it sounds beautiful, then it can't be good. There's a bit of that in the more experimental university composers. We can just do some stuff that sounds good and that children will like. You don't have to spend, down to do 2 degrees to understand what's going on. I think that's it's quite a kind of nice, open-minded, inclusive approach. And so that does mean that you do end up sort of borrowing from everywhere.
So it's quite a bit of an outlandish sort of, outlandish sort of approach to music, isn't it, I guess? But it's, you can sort of do what you want, though, with it.
Yeah. Well, the nice thing, I think, someone said about my dad, was that he was like a musical adventurer, and he'd go off exploring the world and exploring, history. And then just finding little things to bring back in a kind of, like a cabinet of curiosities. So it's sort of, look what we found. And so there is that aspect to it.
And have you got any desires to go on some mad adventures yourself? I know you've done, obviously, Antarctic, and that's the maddest that I can imagine, but have you any got to inspire to do anything crazy yourself? I don't know, getting lost in the jungle or something?
We've got, my partner, her family will still live out in Australia. So we're there for 2 weeks last winter, and then we're going to go again this year. And exploring Australia, I think, is kind of, that's on the cards. It'd be amazing.
Yeah, it's quite barren, isn't it? Especially if you go by past Alice Springs and Ayers Rock to the left or north to the territories.
Up to the top there, it looks mental.
It's just crazy. Just make sure you've got plenty of fuel and water.
exactly. exactly. Or one of those like watches that does emergency beacons or something.
Oh gosh, yeah, you need something. Your phone won't work. I got married in Australia, so I know it'll work quite well. So like your wife does or your missus does. So. But no, amazing place. So I'll ask you one last question, because I know you're going to be busy anyway. With the tour then, I mean, are you all set now? Are you still rehearsing, or are you sort of, is it all?
We're rehearsing. Doing quite a lot of rehearsals this week. Just a standalone show this weekend in Italy. So popping out for that, and then next weekend we're in Hamburg, and then after that, the tour starts on 28th. We're getting there. I mean, it's all quietly optimistic. So at the moment we're just running through all the production schedules and getting everything. Because we're gonna try and make it look good and sound good and that sort of thing, as well as the actual tunes.
So will it be a visual thing as well, or?
We're working on the thing, so we'll be touring touring our own lighting rig, so we'll it's a slight step up for us production wise, because normally we'll work with what we have,
looking forward to it. I'll be with Silo and Cardiff to say hi, and I'll say hello as well, so
perfect.
I'm looking forward to it. Thank you for...
Definitely come and say hi, yeah.
I will do, mate, yeah, but no, I mean, thank you for all the music you've done, and, to respect to your dad, I know he's passed. I mean, your dad died, you were the same age as me when my mum died. I was 17, so you were 18, I guess, he said, weren't you? So I can sort of relate to that, and but your music, honestly, mate, you are talented, very talented man, so...
thank you very much.
So keep at it, and I'll come and say hello in Cardiff anyway. All the best, and like I say, your son or daughter as well. I know it's going to be a challenge for you, but good challenge.
Thank you very much, daughter. Right. Lovely. Thank you. Dude. And brilliant. Cheers, Carl. We'll speak soon.
All right, nice one, mate. Thank you. Cheers. Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks.